We are getting into our third section of control systems, where we will be focusing on stability, what it is, and how we figure out if a system is stable. This video and its accompanying lesson on CircuitBread.com assume you have either gone through all of our preceding lessons, or you are already familiar with the basics of control systems from a different source. In this particular video, we'll be discussing what stability is with respect to control systems, and this should be fairly visually interesting without too much math. Before I jump in, I want to thank Kushal really quick for his work on this series and doing an awesome job on the associated written lesson. You should definitely check it out after watching this video. So let's start with the book definition first to get it out of the way. A system is said to be stable if the system eventually returns to its equilibrium state when the system is subjected to an initial excitation or disturbance. And then the inverse is true. If the response of a system diverges without bound from its equilibrium state upon excitation, then it is unstable. The classic example of stability uses a marble and a bowl. In our first scenario, if the bowl is right side up and the marble is inside, we can flick the marble, which will cause the marble to go up and down and all around the bowl, but will eventually settle back to its original position. This means that it is a stable system. Now, in our second scenario, let's invert that bowl and carefully put the marble on top of the bowl. A small flick will make the marble fall off the bowl, and the marble will never come back to its initial position unless we manually pick it up and put it back. In this second scenario, the system is obviously unstable, even if the marble wouldn't fall without that outside force. There is one more thing I'd like to mention about this example. What if, for the first situation, I flicked the marble really hard or was able to get a golf club in there and whacked it out of the bowl? It's obvious in this case that the marble wouldn't magically return to its initial position if it flew out of the bowl entirely, yet the system is still stable. Those examples are considered unbounded inputs, and they can make it difficult to judge if the system is stable or not. So for us, we can say an input is bounded if the input lies within definite limits of the system. If it's not within the limits of the system, it's an unbounded input. So pretty straightforward. So now we have two rules that we can follow. First, for every bounded input signal, if the system response is also bounded, then that system is stable. Second, for any bounded input, if the system response is unbounded, then that system is unstable. This is commonly called the BIBO stability, or BIBO stability, meaning bounded input, bounded output stability. This is a good visual, intuitive way to figure out if a system is stable. Now, so far, we've been approaching this by looking at the input and output and using a gut check to see if a system is stable. But we can actually tell if a system is stable mathematically. Now, I promised that this wasn't going to have any math, and I wasn't lying, but we will see some math equations, and most importantly, poles and zeros. So let's look at our stereotypical transfer system of G sub S, which is just a ratio of two polynomials. If you've been learning about control systems recently, this format shouldn't induce panic. And if it does, you may want to go back to some of our earlier lessons on the topic and reacquaint yourself. It's not as bad as it looks. I am going to say something now that I've mentioned before, but it's a very important thing to discuss for you to understand, especially as we discuss stability. Each control system has the possibility of poles and zeros. The poles of a system are the roots of the denominator polynomial d sub s, where the poles are the values of s for which d sub s is zero. Note that there can be multiple poles, or multiple values of s, that make d sub s equal zero. Now, the zeros of the system are the roots of the numerator polynomial n sub s, where the zeros are the values of s for which n sub s is zero. Again, there can be multiple zeros or values of s that make n sub s zero. Fortunately, in our generalized equation, it is actually fairly obvious how many poles and zeros a system can have. You have n poles, found in the sub and superscripts in the denominator of the function, and m zeros, again, found in the sub and superscripts, but of the numerator. Now, the location of these poles and zeros on a graph with x-axis as the real axis and the y-axis as the imaginary axis gives us insight into the stability of the system. Let's talk about this graph, provide some general rules, and then wrap this lesson up. As a reminder, our graph with the real and imaginary axis is broken down into the typical four quadrants, with quadrant 1 having both positive real and imaginary parts. Quadrant 2 has a negative real part and a positive imaginary part. Quadrant 3 has a negative real part and a negative imaginary part, while finally, quadrant 4 has a positive real part and negative imaginary part. Now, depending on where our poles lie in these quadrants, we can glean some information about their stability. We have a few different scenarios, though I'll admit this is an incomplete list. As always, for more detail, go check out the written lesson that Kushal put together. So if all the poles lie in the left half of the S-plane, then the system is stable. If any pole lies in the right half of the S-plane, then the system is unstable. If the system has two or more poles in the same location on the imaginary axis, then the system is unstable. And finally, if the system has one or more non-repeated poles on the imaginary axis, then the system is marginally stable. Unfortunately, it's not always as easy as just looking at a graph to understand its stability. In those cases of marginal stability, or with even more poles, or poles in different locations, you can't just tell visually whether or not the system is stable. There is a way to establish stability without calculating the poles using the Routh-Hurwitz criterion, which I really, really hope I'm pronouncing correctly. We're going to spend at least one, if not two, lessons learning about the Routh-Hurwitz criterion. Unlike this lesson, those will have math, so prepare yourself. It isn't too bad, though, so don't psych yourself out. As for this lesson, we learned conceptually what stability is, learned about bounded inputs and outputs, reviewed the concepts of poles and zeros, and started to develop an understanding of how pole location on the real versus imaginary graph affects the stability of the system. I want to take a moment to thank our friends of CircuitBread who support us in our mission to bring this content to you. The best way to support us is to go check out our friends and see if any of their tools, products, or information help you become a better engineer. As always, if you like this video, give it a like, subscribe to the channel, all that good stuff, and we will catch you in the next one. Take care. Hey, we hope you enjoyed the video. Did you know that CircuitBread.com also has a ton of other stuff, including free electronics and electrical engineering tools? Besides a scientific calculator, we have a few dozen other tools, including a delta Y calculator, LED resistor calculator, a binary, decimal, hexadecimal, and more converter, as well as a slew of other unit converters. Go check them out!